Hello, and welcome everyone, and thank you for being here, and a special Morgan welcome to our visitors from the University of Pennsylvania. And for those of you who have never visited here, Morgan, or our building here at CBEIS, my name is Laurel McSherry, and I direct the Graduate Landscape Architecture Program. The focus of my talk this afternoon is a recent exhibition at the University of Pennsylvania's Arthur Ross Gallery, and it's called A Book of Days. The exhibition was mounted for 3 months last summer by the Weitzman School of Design in celebration of the 50th anniversary of the publication of a book, Design with Nature, by Scottish-American landscape architect Ian McHarg. A Book of Days was organized around work that I produced over 6 months as a 2018 Fulbright scholar at the Glasgow School of Art. Some of the works appear, some of the works from the exhibition appear in the book, and in fact on the cover of another book, the newly published Design with Nature Now, which is another reason why we've gathered here this afternoon to celebrate the launch of this timely and timeless anthology. Today I'll show you some work from the exhibition and share some thoughts about their production. But first I wanted to tell you three sort of moments, influential moments, that I think would be useful in understanding my journey to make this work and also contribute to some of the themes. On the left is an image of Highlands, New Jersey, and on the right, and in the center, one of my father. In many ways, it was in my father's work that I found a starting point for my own. He was trained as an engineer, but he was also a mason of great skill. And it was in Highlands, in a house that he made by hand, where I first learned what it meant to build in place. Fast forward 15 years or so to a lecture hall on the Rutgers campus, the site of my second influential moment. On the left is an image of Hickman Hall, and on the right, one of Albany Street in downtown New Brunswick. Every university, including Morgan State, has at least one building like Hickman Hall, a hardworking and reliable structure that every day hosts a stream of lectures back to back and across disciplines. On this particular day, I'm in Hickman for the start of a new course, Environmental Design Analysis. The instructor is a landscape architect, and it's my first encounter with one. And on the screen are pairs of slides that he's made around the city and across the state. Images of extraordinarily ordinary things like parking lots and fence lines and jug handles. His lecture wasn't a portal to an abstract or an intangible world, no window into some ancient art practice. In fact, it was the absolute opposite, an exacting description of exactly the business going on outside. His intention wasn't to make the world go away, but to help us see and understand something of it. And it was in that moment when I realized that studying the built environment was a legitimate human pursuit. Fast forward one last time to another darkened auditorium, now years later, to Baltimore's Senator Theater, and on the screen, the film Smoke. Set in Brooklyn during the summer of 1990, Smoke follows the lives of five people connected to each other through their friendship with the owner of a cigar shop, a man named Augie Wren. In the years since I first saw Smoke, one scene in particular has haunted me and has served as a touchstone for how I think about my work and landscape. And it's a scene I'm going to share with you now.
Run out of Schultz pedics?
Was I get back a couple off him before you leave?
No problem. Says don't rush you off to the opera or anything.
Someone forgot a camera.
Yeah, I did.
It's yours?
It's mine, all right. I've owned that little sucker for a long time.
You took pictures?
I guess you could call it a hobby. Only takes you 5 minutes a day to do it, but I do it every day. Rain or shine, steal the snow. Sort of like the postman.
Just some guy who pushed his coins across the counter.
Well, that's what people see. That ain't necessarily what I am.
That's right.
With 4,000 pictures of the same place. The corner of 3rd Street and 7th Avenue at 8 o'clock in the morning. 4,000 straight days in all kinds of weather. That's why I can never take a vacation. I gotta be in my spot every morning at the same time. Every morning in the same spot at the same time.
I've never seen anything like this.
It's my project. What you'd call my life's work.
Amazing. I'm not sure I get it, though. I mean, what was it that gave you the idea to do this project?
I don't know. It just came to me. It's my corner, after all. I mean, it's just one little part of the world, but things take place there too, just like everywhere else. It's a record of my little spot.
It's kind of overwhelming.
Get it. Don't slow down, my friend.
What do you mean?
I mean, you're going too fast. You're hardly even looking at the pictures.
They're all the same.
They're all the same, but each one is different from every other one. You got your bright mornings and your dark mornings. You got your summer light and your autumn light. You got your weekdays and your weekends. You got your people in overcoats and galoshes, and you got your people in t-shirts and shorts. Sometimes the same people, sometimes different ones. Sometimes the different ones become the same. And the same ones disappear. The earth revolves around the sun, and every day the light from the sun hits the earth at a different angle.
It's Ellen.
Yeah, it's all right. She's in quite a few from that, yeah. Must have been on the way to work.
It's Ellen.
Each of us, in our own way, is Augie Wren, attending to the world that we've been given and trying our best to make something of consequence with it. For me, Augie's project is a reminder of the magical capacity of art and design to give again to the world. And that world is as much the everyday world as it is anything more grand. Four themes connect the works that comprise A Book of Days, four themes that are also embodied in the image on the screen. The first theme is time, how we experience time, and how we struggle to record our experiences in the world. Each of the works I'll be showing you in some way registers the passage of time as a sequence of moments or longer durations or some combination of the two. A second theme is the significance of increments and the power in their accumulation. A third theme is the interrelationship of what's tangible and what's implied. And finally, number four is the value of a datum, a physical or temporal device against which change can be perceived. In the interview that appears in the exhibition brochure, I share a story about the roots of its title, which extend forward in time from the pages of my mother's diary and her life as a young woman in New York City during the Second World War. While these stories in themselves were remarkable, equally compelling was the structure of the diary itself, which juxtaposed a single horizontal plot expressed in days against multiple vertical ones that were expressed in years. My Book of Days explores this distinction, the difference between calendar days that repeat and lived days that don't. There's no landscape architecture program at the Glasgow School of Art, and so choosing it as the location for my Fulbright was a provocation, an opportunity to join a community of artists, to learn something of their practices, and to reflect on, and with luck, to expand my own. The first work I'm going to show you originated in a train timetable. As a Fulbright scholar in the UK, I was invited to attend a symposium at both the beginning and the end of my six-month fellowship. This meant traveling south from Glasgow to Birmingham in early January and east from Glasgow to Edinburgh in late June. Since it was important to me to make both journeys in the daylight, I began to compare possible arrival and departure times against sunrise and sunset charts. What I discovered was that over the course of 6 months, Glasgow would experience a dramatic increase in daylight from 7 to 17 and a half hours. And it would do so in daily increments of between 1 and 5 minutes. Immediately, I became fascinated with the idea of developing physical analogs for this. One takes the form of digital video and operates as both a calendar and a clock. The piece is a collection of observations ranging in 1 to 5 minutes, which I shot daily and assembled in sequence. That's the calendar part, which played on the right. To act as the clock, I paired each observation with a cinema clip of equal duration drawn from films that were screened at the legendary Glasgow Film Theater during my time there. These played on the left. The intention of the work is to prompt our thoughts about the fullness and the emptiness of both lived and constructed time. The final installation is 10 and a half hours long, and which was longer than the opening times for the gallery where it was shown. The portion I'm going to show you now is only 9 minutes. It's 9 of 630 minutes, and includes 5 scene pairs that increase in duration from 1 minute to 3 minute, and then back again to 1 minute. When I exhibited the work at the Arthur Ross, I muted the cinema scenes in favor of the street photography. However, for this special reel that I prepared for you all, the two soundtracks are going to play simultaneously. And like today, all the scenes that you'll see on the right are Wednesdays.
You gonna call her?
Oh, yeah, your lady friend, the one who gave you a business card.
I don't know.
What? Pick up the phone. Life's short. One day, it's gone. You and I make it out of this alive, you should call. Phil was dead?
Whoa. What happened?
He drove his car off Mulholland.
What happened?
That car crashed. The funeral was today.
So that's why you're such a wreckhead. You were at the funeral. That'd wreck anybody. Was it sad?
Everybody's in the suits. You do the things. Everybody's there. Everybody's in line. all the cars in line. Everybody's in the cars on the lot. You get to the cemetery, and the priest has got some more to say. Top. There's the hole. You put them in. Blah, blah, blah.
Was it sad?
There was at the grave. There were like a bunch of dogs. And this guy was singing with this beautiful voice. He had this beautiful high voice. All alone, no organ or anything. Just his voice. And the priest could have said anything. Nice things, sad things, nothing. And this guy, nobody even knew who he was, would sing. And you couldn't even really pick out the words, even. You know, you just heard this high, beautiful, sad, just this human sound. And then everybody just started crying along with him.
You know something, Eddie? I didn't really go to all the places on my bag. I actually went out of here north towards San Francisco, but I got no further than Oxnard.
I know where Oxnard is.
Great.
What's so great about me knowing where Oxnard is?
It's great when people know what each other are talking about. I mean, isn't that what we've been talking about?
I don't care. Look, Owen, I'm just not in the mood, okay?
Never showed it to anyone before.
Oh, right, look at it.
No, it's okay.
Show me the collection.
No, you don't mean it.
Show me the damn coins.
All right.
This one is a nickel. This one also is a nickel. And here's a quarter. And another quarter. And a penny.
See? Nickel, nickel, quarter, quarter, penny.
Are any of these coins worth anything?
No. And here is another nickel.
Why do you have them? What do you mean? Well, the purpose of a coin collection is that the coins are worth something, Owen.
Oh, but they are. This one here, I got change. My dad took me to see Peter, Paul, and Mary. And this one, I got in change when I bought a hot dog at the circus. My daddy let me keep the change. He always let me keep the change. This one is my favorite. This is Martin and Lewis at the Hollywood Palladium. Look at that. See the way it shines on a little eagle? Love my dad a lot.
So this whole collection is...
Change my daddy let me keep. What was his name? Ned. He used to call me his little Ned. That's why Mama named me Owen. I really miss him.
It's a real nice collection.
Thank you, Larry. It's a real nice
collection. Shirley Abbott. And across Route 424 to the Recreation Center pool, and up the hill and I'm home. Well, don't you see? I just figured it out. If I take a sort of a dog leg to the southwest, I can swim home.
Come on, Ned.
Why would you want to swim home?
I don't get it.
Pool by pool, they form a river. All the way to our house.
Well, I suppose you could put it that way. now, Nettie. Why don't you sit down and have a drink, and then we'll all go to the grave.
I'll call it the Lucinda Room, after my wife.
Quite a tribute.
This is the day Ned Merrill swims across the country.
Meanwhile, in the print workshop, I pursued the same subject matter through different means, using engraving and etching to record Glasgow's changing daylight, making time, in a sense, topographic. On the left is a group of six prints from my daylight series. I created the work by engraving a 4-inch steel plate and etching it in a sequence of acid baths of increasing duration, each of which was equivalent in time to the increment of daylight in hours that I gained each month from January till June. In other words, the acid became my son, my surrogate son. Since each exposure to the acid had the effect of both erasing and enhancing markings on the plate, I made prints at each stage to document the change. For instance, the print in the upper left was produced after exposing the steel to acid for an hour, which was represented January, while the print in the lower right, which was made at plate stage 6, was produced after a cumulative exposure in the acid of 10.5 hours. Several works in the show, including this group, employ what is called blind embossing, which uses no ink. My decision to blind emboss was motivated by a desire to engage the sheer force of the press and the dynamics of natural light to render the images, making them intentionally difficult to photograph, and so best experienced in person. These two images are part of a study in relief printing. In relief printing, ink is applied to the surface of a plate with a roller. In the study, I was interested in understanding how rollers of different hardnesses and inks of different densities or viscosities might recover different information in the strata of a single plate. For the print on the right, I applied black with two different types of hardnesses of roller. The softer of the two, because it was pliable, more pliable, made contact with the mid layers of the plate, while the harder one traveled only across its surface. So when I brought the plate in contact with paper, the mid levels were rendered gray and the upper surface black, and the areas that were deeply recessed remained free of ink. I repeated the process for the image on the left, but instead of using black ink, I used different colors of different viscosities. And when I passed the paper through the press, the three colors printed simultaneously, but variations in their densities prevented them from mixing. These are the two plates, sort of the final condition of the two plates for these first and second series. I thought you might find that sort of fascinating to see the material. This next group of prints were experiments in intaglio, which is the opposite, essentially, of relief printing. Intaglio images result from ink that's worked into the plate by hand and catches in the indentations, and those indentations are made either directly with a tool or indirectly with acid. Under pressure, the paper is pushed into these indentations, and it results in the creation of a three-dimensional inked image, inked surface, which is different than screen printing or lithographs, which are only two-dimensional. So the image here on the left is from the initial plate stage in this series, and representing January for this series. The image on the right is the state of the plate after I was finished printing with it at plate stage 6. This final group of prints is a set of embossed reliefs. Okay, which were made by applying ink with a roller. Reading left to right, you'll note that there is a change in the amount of white, and if you were meeting these in person, you would also notice that there's a change in the height, sort of the amplitude of that white area off the paper, which corresponds to the increase in the biting of that steel plate in longer exposures to the acid. Since the plate that produced the image all the way to the left was sacrificed to make the image immediately to its right, and so on, and so on, and so on. Each print is both an ending and a beginning, simultaneously a mooring and a threshold, and an apt sentiment for the cover of a book. A book of days includes a range of drawing types. And while some might not look like landscape, to my mind, they do share an important characteristic with land. Both contain material that's tangible, and it's through this material that other material, such as less firm material or ephemeral material, is suggested or it's implied. This is a portion of a longer drawing, or a larger drawing, that's called Dual Transect. It's a 20-foot long piece that I produced through a combination of digital drawing, photo engraving, and field photography. Dual Transect was inspired by three things: a longitudinal profile of the River Clyde, drawn in 1888 by engineer William Miller; a collection of squeezes that I made roughly 20 years ago in Rome; and a book, Haldane's 1960s work, The Drove Roads of Scotland. So a squeeze is a paper impression of an inscribed surface made in the field by archaeologists. In other words, it's a portable version of something that is otherwise immovable. So Dual Transect began with my desire to make a portable record of the locations of fords along the fall and the reach of the Clyde. Fords are shallow river sections that traditionally were used by drovers to move livestock from one river bank to the other. Over time, the nature of these crossings changed. Some were firmed up in the form of ropeways or ferries or bridges, and others remained soft, and eventually they vanished. So working across book and map collections, I created a drawing of these locations. And for the students here in the audience, the drawing for me became as much a site of discovery as it was an illustration, because it revealed more to me what I came to learn than reinforcing what I already knew. That drawing, the Red Clyde, gave rise to this pair of blind embossings of the River Clyde. As a gesture to McHarg, who spent much of his adult life in the watershed of a second river, I repeated the process for the Delaware, which remarkably has the same fall of 1,000 feet from its headwaters to its bay. Discovering this moved me to overlay the two transects, an act that presented new challenges since the Delaware is 3 times the length of the Clyde, and so beyond the dimensions of a conventional printing press, so I couldn't emboss the Dual Transect. What first seemed like a hurdle ultimately became an opportunity for me to reimagine this piece as a landscape painting. And with the help of the School of Arts Center for Advanced Textiles, to realize the work as an extended drawing on fabric. In the painted version, the color of each line is drawn from sampling photographs made in the field at each location. Another drawing in the show also has echoes of McHarg, in particular a poignant section of Design with Nature where he describes his childhood walking practice and its influence on his understanding of the Scottish landscape. His practice included southeast walks from Glasgow from his home in Clydebank, and northerly ones which led him up into its surrounding hills. Walk Calendar is a 6-month record of my own walking practice within the Glasgow neighborhood of Garnet Hill. I made the work by assembling 180 separate drawings, one made each morning to illustrate where I traveled the day before. My intention was to document how the navigation of an unfamiliar city changed over the course of my living there. And in the drawing, seven colors differentiate the 7 days of the week. The final piece to show you this afternoon was prompted by a book, this book, and the many bilingual signs that I observed throughout Scotland, bilingual in their use of both English and Scots Gaelic, which is a language constructed from an 18-letter alphabet, the pronunciations of each letter derived from the names of trees or plants. My Scots Gaelic alphabet references these 18 species, and I'll identify them for you. From the left, elm, birch, hazel, oak, aspen, beech, walnut, hawthorn, yew, larch, maple, ash, box, viburnum, elder, willow, linden, and apple. Sourcing wood for the project led me to the Galgale, a community of woodworkers in South Glasgow neighborhood of Govan. For several hundred years, the identity of most Govan residents was derived from shipbuilding, though today nearly all maritime-related work along the Clyde is gone. The Galgale responds by helping residents regain confidence and acquire new skills, and by challenging the negative ideas that they may have about themselves and their worth and what they are capable of offering to themselves and their families and their community. In addition to building boats, traditional boats, the Galgale processes native timber. During my time in Glasgow, I returned weekly to the Galgale to prepare meals, or to help prepare meals, for their open workshop nights. And it was through these weekly trips that I became more aware of sites like these, former council housing sites, where structures and ways of life and identities had been erased within living memory. In the context of Govan, or our own seaboard cities of Baltimore or Philadelphia, questions emerge. How does one recreate community in a fundamentally altered place? Or on what basis does one rebuild a lost sense of wellness? For me, the promise of the Galgale, like the promise of the alphabet, individual stories collected by a single unifying one brings us full circle. Time, increment, illusion, frame. These are some of the words that create the backward-facing lens into my book of days. Words that echo back to me some of the things that make our world the world in front of the work somewhat more sensible and precious and full. You're a lovely audience. Thank you. Some people may have been curious. I'm going to minimize you after. So some people were curious. I heard some of the films that were showing on the left-hand side, and so maybe this clarifies some little argument you might have had in the audience.
So first of all, I'd like to thank Professor McSherry and thank Morgan State for having us here. My name is Fritz Steiner, and I'm the dean of the Stuart Weitzman School at the University of Pennsylvania. And what I'm going to do, my talk is very brief, and what I'm going to do is sort of form a bridge between the work of the Book of Days and put it in the context of the broader project that we did that was referenced by Professor McSherry. And we'll have everything ready to go in a second. Thank you. So, Ian Park, as we mentioned, was born in Glasgow, Scotland, in 1920, and died in the Delaware River Valley in Chester County, Pennsylvania, in 2001. And in 1969, he published a book, Design with Nature. So when I returned to the University of Pennsylvania, I was a student there twice, and had worked around the country. And when I returned to Philadelphia a couple years ago, something became very clear, was we were approaching the 50th anniversary of Design with Nature, and that we should do something to celebrate that. And it's especially important, I think, to be here in Baltimore because of the really pivotal role that Baltimore played in McHarg's life and in his practice and in the ideas of Design with Nature. He, and certainly the people in Baltimore are probably very well aware of this, when the firm was founded, which was called Wallace McHarg Associates, their first two projects were the plan for the harbor, the plan for the valleys, and there are several people from the Valley's Planning Council here tonight, as well as the Baltimore Inner Harbor. That's a pretty good beginning of two projects, arguably one of the most important and influential environmental planning projects of the late 20th century, and one of the most important urban design projects of the late 20th century. The plan for the valleys, David Wallace was the former planning director for Baltimore, and he led most of the urban-oriented projects, and McHarg led most of the more landscape-oriented projects. But what they did with the Inner Harbor plan in particular was they gave a vision. Again, this is well known here. I-95 was going to go right in front of the harbor. They gave a vision of what it could be without. And now I've...
Thank you. Everything, now I'm mic'd up. Thanks a bunch. So our publisher was the Lincoln Institute. And we have a representative from the Lincoln Institute here, and we're going to sell books. And we had our first book launch at the Lincoln Institute in October when the book came out. And we had two of our authors, our contributors to the book, were from Baltimore. And at the end of the presentation, I said, we're going to have book launches in Philadelphia, in Washington, D.C., in New York, and they both came up to me and said, what about Baltimore? We should do something in Baltimore. So that's the genesis of this event tonight. So my co-editors are Richard Weller, Karen McCluskey, and Billy Fleming at the University of Pennsylvania. I kind of like to think of this as sort of four of us, and we had sort of fifth Beatle, Bill Whittaker, who was our curator. And Bill, I'll explain Bill's role in a moment, as well as your own Laurel McSherry. So this was the five people that did much of the work related to Design with Nature now. And I mentioned we were going to celebrate the 50th anniversary. A logical thing would be do a book or do an exhibit or do a conference, but instead we did a book, a conference, a special issue of a journal, and three exhibits. The exhibits we held a conference last June. There were about 500 attendees. We opened it on the summer solstice. Some of our speakers and contributors to the book, the person on your right is Earl Ellis from the University of Maryland Baltimore County. So he was one of the, is Earl here? No, I didn't. And we received generous sponsors from a variety of firms and backers. We also, we did three exhibits. One, the house we lived in was a pretty much a review of McHarg's life and his contributions. We did Design with Nature Now, which was 25 projects that we chose from around the world that we exemplify McHarg's ideas today. And then we have a book of days, which Professor McSherry just described in some detail. So these three exhibits were from, two of the exhibits were lasted 3 months from June to September. McHarg's, the exhibit about McHarg's life, the house we lived in stayed up until November. And these are some images from the exhibits. And this, a quick review of the book. We have five themes which we think look at the important issues that we're facing today, especially in relation to climate change, big wilds, urban futures, rising tides, fresh waters, and toxic lands. This is the content. You can see Professor McSherry sort of developed also the theme of the graphic layout of the book that was repeated through as well. So these are the projects that we collected and exhibited. For example, with Big Wilds, we looked at the Yellowstone to Yukon Conservation Initiative, the Malapai borderlands in New Mexico, a project in New Zealand, one in Indonesia, and one in China. This shows the Yukon to Yellowstone project. In urban futures, we looked at the Willamette Drainage Basin, Envision Utah, planning in Medellin, Colombia, a project in China, and one in someplace else that I can't read at the moment. So this is an example of the work in Medellin. Rising tides, we looked at two different visions for Manhattan, ideas about adapting to climate change in Norfolk, Virginia, as well as two projects in the Netherlands. These are just some examples of the projects from the North Sea, as well as two different visions for Manhattan. Fresh waters deals with our water future, including the future of the Great Lakes, the Los Angeles River, Green Plan Philadelphia, a project in China, and another in the Netherlands. This is the Room for the River in the Netherlands, a complete reworking of the water systems in the Netherlands. And then toxic lands, how we will recover from lands that we polluted, projects from Germany, the United States, and England. This is a wonderful project in the Ruhr Valley in Germany. And all of that, all of those projects and the activities led us to create the new McHarg Center at the University of Pennsylvania. One of the projects we're taking on is providing a design vocabulary for the Green New Deal. My colleague Billy Fleming is leading this. If you're interested in the Green New Deal, and if you're interested in the McHarg Center, and if you're on Twitter, believe me, you can go there and you'll get 20 messages a day from Billy Fleming about the Green New Deal and ideas about design. It's gotten a lot of attention. We also now are taking the three exhibits. We're going quite appropriately to Glasgow in November. You probably know that Glasgow is the site of the World the UN Climate Conference next November. We will have three exhibits. All three of the exhibits will be there. We also probably will be in China, the Netherlands, and Canada. With that, what I'd like to do again is to thank you for being here. And we have a reception right behind. And both Professor McSherry and I are here if you want to chat with us. If you want to buy books, we have Emma from the Lincoln Institute here. And with that, again, thank you very much for being here.